I now give the floor to the representative of Sri Lanka.
Mr. President, may I thank the Republic of Kenya for arranging this initiative. Sri Lanka, Mr. President, is deeply concerned that despite global policy developments and commitments to support women, there remains significant structural barriers and the lack of access for them to be fully represented at all levels of decision-making, including in peace processes. We appreciate that the United Nations, as the primary international body, vested with the responsibility of maintaining international peace and security, is committed to increase the number of civilians and uniformed women in peacekeeping at all levels and in all positions, including senior leadership positions. The United Nations understands gender equality as a goal to ensure equal rights, responsibilities, and opportunities of women and men and girls and boys. The strategy to achieve gender equality is gender mainstreaming, which entails bringing the perceptions, experiences, knowledge, and interests of women and men to bear on policymaking, planning, and decision-making. Mr. President, Sri Lanka has made a positive contribution to global peacekeeping efforts, and the valor and the professionalism of the Sri Lankan Blue Helmets are widely appreciated. Mr. President, as we seek to invest in women peacekeeping and peace building, it is essential to better understand and address the problems they face to participating in peacekeeping, particularly the cultural and social aspects. We need assistance to continue advocacy to encourage women's participation in peacekeeping operations with developing countries, provided with resources, training materials, and sharing of best practices for recruitment and deployment of uniformed women. It is our considered view that women who are already involved in informal peace processes need to be included in formal peace processes in order to establish meaningful gender equality and peace, and that many women's understandings of peace building are far broader and more holistic than UN or traditional usages. The CSW's appraisal acknowledges the growth in civil war, armed conflict, and terrorism, with a concomitant abuse of the human rights of women and girls by state and non-state actors. The changing nature of conflict means that most wars are fought internally, often rooted in unresolved historical bitterness relating to ethnic conflicts or disputes over diamonds, drugs, or minerals. The protagonists are not necessarily soldiers, but political ideologues, warlords, drug dealers, state actors, disenfranchised youth, and young children. Mr. President, in this process, we must, I believe, examine the rationale of traditional views that are often expressed, justifying the participation of women in peacekeeping based on the foundation that women are more empathetic, approachable, and peaceful than men, that they are better positioned to relate to women and children and deal with issues such as sexual violence, and the women contribute soft skills to missions. Now, aren't these, I ask, notions discriminatory in itself? Does such thinking not place the burden on women? Mr. President, if we are to truly make progress, we must, first of all, change our mindset and sincerely treat women and men on equal terms in all walks of life. I ask the question, isn't it then surprising that although women are active in community peace building, they are almost completely absent from political negotiating tables? The exclusions from peace tables are notable. The examples are a matter of a disappointing record. Shouldn't women then, as a must, be present at negotiating tables? The answer simply is yes. Firstly, because women are affected by conflict and thus by consequence of peace agreement. Secondly, related to the first point, women's inclusion in all stages of peace processes is crucial for inclusive social justice. And finally, the presence of women makes a difference to the sorts of issues generally brought to the formal peace processes. One sees that inhibitive constraints upon women's involvement in decision-making are enormous in all regions, but are particularly acute in conflict areas. While entire communities suffer disastrous consequences of armed conflict, women and girls are affected specifically because of their subordinate position. A peace settlement, Mr. President, is not merely about ending a war, but also about establishing the conditions for a new just polity. My second point is that women's absence from negotiating tables minimizes the possibility of inclusive just politics arising in post-conflict times. It has been observed that women's relative absence from negotiating tables is significant because when they are present or participate in less formal negotiations, they tend to induce different issues, and frequently women adopt different approaches to conflict resolution. I will wind up by referring to what authors of the article Women Waging War, published in Foreign Policy magazine May to June 2001, very pithily said, quote, "Allowing men who plan wars to plan peace, they say, is a bad habit," close quotes. They suggest that while men come to the negotiating table directly from the war room or the battlefield, women generally come from family care and civilian activism. Now, Mr. President, I ask finally, isn't that food for thought? Thank you.
I thank the representative of Sri Lanka for his statement.